This is Screen Junkies Movie Fights, brought to you by Loot Crate. Now your host, Andy Signore.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to an epic, weird edition of Movie Fights. That's right. Today, we are going weird. You know, a lot of times in the comments, they complain, where's the regulars? Where are they? Where are they coming? Well, they're here today, and we're giving it to you. We're giving it to you hard. We're going to go full weird, because you know what? I don't like when they demand something. If they demand it, I'm going to really give it to you. So you've been complaining. We brought the regulars here, and we're going full weird. We're embracing it. There's nothing really topical here. That's a couple, maybe, but get excited, because I don't even want to tease this. Actually, let's tease this. They're going to be pitching Cars 6. They're going to be telling us who Helen Mirren's love interest in Fast the Furious 8 should be. And they're going to be casting Avengers as if it was the 90s. Plus so much more you're not going to want to miss. Each round's going to be funny. I'm telling you, get excited. Dan Murrell, I'm going to you first, because yeah, you're just already laughing. This is going to be a weird episode.
You wanted this.
Well, they kept demanding it, right?
Where are the regular? We try to bring. We spend a lot of time. We want to bring cool new people on and to let them know that we're so here.
God,
you got them.
It's never enough.
You want them? You got them.
Can never be enough. Where's everybody? Got to do a complete. I don't care. They hate me. They'll keep hating me. I don't care. But yeah. God, guys, we have fun doing the show. It's not fun when all you do is complain. So, anyway, we listen, and now we're going to give it to you full on, and I can't wait, because this is going to be insane. Dan, next to you, Pete, you came on an episode, fan camp, you came on a very weird episode. Are you excited?
I'm super excited.
You saw a little tease of what's about to come.
I did, and you viewers are in for a show.
All right, I'm glad we hyped it. One more thing before I get started, because it's going to go crazy. Stay tuned for the end of the show, because we are about to announce the lineup for next week's Drunk Movie Fights 2! What?! That's right. Stay tuned for the end, and I'll tell you more details. But let's get to this episode. I think we have some really good music to start up. First up, he's making his debut. He's one of the writers of Honest Trailers. You've been demanding he come here, and he got demanded into this third chair. Congrats to him. I'm excited for him to make his debut here. Ladies and gentlemen, Joe Starr! Joe! I love this song. A fan made you this song.
I'm honored. Thank you, Dave B, for giving me some jams.
What do you call it?
He called
Turn
it
up.
He called it this.
He called it Burn Like a Joe Starr. Burning Like a Joe Starr.
That's a solid star pun.
And what, yes, you have a belt?
Yeah, I have the Tournament of Nerds Championship, How Rednecks Show at UCB, which I'm the reigning defending champion of, which I beat Mike Carlson for.
Whoa.
So I just wanted to keep that on the table today.
Speaking of Mike Carlson, you know him, a fan favorite and the creator of Hashtag Botanicus. It is Mike Carlson! Hello, sir.
Hello, what's going on today?
I think Mike brought a jam that you wrote yourself.
Yes, I wrote this a few years ago for a musical on stage.
Is the whole album available?
Not available commercially, but if you'd like it, I can make you a CD.
I think we need to kickstart that thing.
All right.
Throw it on Bandcamp.
It was called Zoo Dreams. It was about animals trying to be in the San Diego Zoo. They were auditioning. It was like a chorus line.
I don't think you have to ask us. I think we definitely would. Can we add vocals?
I have vocals.
Oh, all right. Let's talk more about
this. They just weren't pertinent to
but
the
hashtag,
situation.
Yeah. Fat Carlson.
Can we get my antennae in the shot?
No? Okay.
All right. Mike's here. Joe's here. But we can't. This would not be a weird movie fight without this gentleman. He's the host of Mundy Night Raw, which airs here every 4 o'clock Monday on Screen Junkies Plus. He's our resident fixer, and he knows a guy named The Rock. It's Nick Mundy! Music. Woo! Nick picked some really quiet music.
Yep.
This is
that sounds like my
that
music.
Sounds like Mike's song. JT, come on, JT. This is. There you go. Here it is. Dun, dun! There we go. Nick Flair, right?
Fire me! I'm already fired. Fire me! I'm already fired. Woo! We're gonna be styling and profiling tonight!
And shedding.
Yeah.
Real shedding.
Taking off pants.
It's like Birdemic in here.
Woo! Fire me, Andy!
Are you gonna stay in the whole show or are you gonna sit?
Yeah, screw it. Let's do this thing.
I'm too tall to stand.
All right, well, there you go. Dan, Dan and Pete over there, are you guys excited for this round?
I
I said before, I don't know if this will be my busiest or least busy show. Yes, I'm not sure which one it's
going to
be.
I promise you all at home, this will be the weirdest fight we've done. We'll see how it goes. But we put on Facebook a poll, and these guys all submitted some, and we picked the weirdest topics we could. Fun ones, don't get me wrong. These are going to be fun. But these are debates we probably wouldn't have normally done, and we went full weird on this. So you guys excited?
A lot of people are brave enough to do these.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. This is going to be so weird,
is it to hear
you guys.
Over your ear.
These are in my ears.
Andy,
you're fine.
I don't consider this show a success until Dan leaves in disgust.
Okay, that until, we know now.
Until
the,
we ruin the integrity of movie fights in front of Dan's eyes.
So your antenna is in every shot.
Hey, that's pretty good. This is pretty sweet.
All right, guys. Well, you know how this works. Again, let's go. Let's get to it. But before we do, I have to thank our sponsor today. I'm very happy to have them. Do you have it over there, Dan, I believe?
Do I?
Yes, you do.
No,
there we go.
Me.
It's queuing you up. Here we go.
I didn't know
today's
that.
Today's episode, it's brought to you by the one and only Loot Crate. We love Loot Crate.
We
Loot Crate
do.
Is the best.
Woo!
Dan is opening up a Loot Crate as I
up.
Speak.
Wow.
The coolest geek and gamer box around. Each month, Loot Crate delivers 6 to 8 curated items around a theme, many of which are exclusive and totally awesome. Check this out.
I'm looking.
Dan got, what'd you get? Is that the Infinity Gauntlet Oven Mitt?
It's an oven mitt.
Whoa. What?
What?
What? I think it's just for show and not actual oven use,
is,
but still pretty awesome.
Who knows? It doesn't say.
Oh, and Pete's holding up a Dragon Ball over
Dragon
there.
Ball.
That is a pretty cool Dragon Ball. I assume it's a Dragon Ball.
Yes. I have a Hulk.
Seems like it.
Oh, that is a cool Hulk. I actually have that on my desk.
Yeah, what is this? This is like opening
Hulk
an
stuff.
Actual Loot Crate. Yeah, I don't
like,
even know what's in here.
It's like the holidays. It's like your birthday right now.
We snuck an unboxing video.
This is a Warcraft shirt. This is what this is.
That is a cool.
I didn't know who this guy was until I believe that's Durotan.
Oh wow, look
it
at
looks
you.
Looks like Durotan. I know Warcraft's a little bit though. Yeah.
Guys, I can't wait for the dystopia themed crate this month actually. And if you order now, it can get shipped to your door for less than $20 a month. Get yourself some loot and help support us in the process. You can click the annotations or go to lootcrate.com/moviefights to save 10% off your new subscription by using code moviefights. That's right. That's right there, lootcrate.com/moviefights and use code moviefights for 10% off your new subscription today. And you have until 6:19 at 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time to receive the Dystopia Crate, which I'm excited for because it includes RoboCop, Terminator 2,
Ooh.
The Matrix, and more. That's some
wow.
cool stuff, right, guys?
Yes. Very cool, yes.
Thank you, Loot Crate. We love you. And now, let's do this.
More like, Loot Crate.
Great.
Now let's do this. This
is where guys, we're all on Molly. We're all on Molly.
Fight.
Fight.
Molly
I
fights.
I told you to do that quiet privately. Okay, sorry. I might start. I'm just going weird today. Round one.
Pull it out, Andy.
Oh, it's out.
Okay, good.
You can look.
Let's get Turge.
Okay, this one came from Ryan at Dunk7309. This meme's been going around all over the internet. I heard Reddit shut down because it was so popular, because people were casting these out. So we're going to try and do it. I couldn't think of something weirder for this crew. I want you guys to pitch the Marvel Avengers 2012 film, that lineup, as if it was cast in the 90s. So you can only use stars of the era of the 90s that were, you know, they can be big, small, but we got to, you know, somebody who would have been working in that time period. Who would you cast? And you got to pick me, Captain America, Iron Man, Thor, Hulk, Black Widow, Hawkeye, and Nick Fury. And we have some visual aids as you're talking. Mike Carlson, you're up first. Who are you pitching us? And we have a visual aid if you're ready for
it. All right. I am ready for it. Are you talking to me or are you talking to the fans?
For you.
Okay, great. I'm ready. All right. We start with Iron Man. What do we want from Iron Man? We want somebody who is suave, somebody who is funny, and somebody who can kick some ass. Now, I am talking about Raul Julia. The great, I don't know why there are chuckles going on, because Raul Julia, if you've seen any of his work, is all of those things and more, maybe more so than Robert Downey Jr. Have you seen Adam's Family Values or the first Adam's Family called just the Adam's Family? They are both great. They are both amazing performances. Gomez Adams is basically Tony Stark with the dial turned a little bit up. All right, on to Captain America. We want somebody who in real life has the spirit of America. He believes in patriotism and the troops. I'm talking about a guy like Gary Sinise. All right, this is a guy who plays in the Lieutenant Dan band, donates money to the troops. He cares. Chris Evans is a great Captain America, okay? That is a very good job of also spoiling the rest of my
Sorry.
Picks.
Sorry, yeah.
But yeah, look, I understand.
Looks like you got Raul Julius Cadaver.
I want you to get a little quicker. Go. Tell us your lineup.
I really was pontificating there. All right. Mel Gibson, Thor. We're talking 90s Gibson, folks. He is incredible. We loved him. There was none of that funny business that we came to
the
later.
The racism.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about. None of that was. This is the 90s. Everything was great. Just give him some human growth hormone and he's great. All right. Go up to the Hulk. We want somebody as Bruce Banner who is a person we like, but also kind of has brooding and sort of has a dark side. That is Robin Williams. He's done that in comedy. He's done that in drama. He's done it in everything. And also, the Hulk can now do some topical impressions. All right? If you want the Hulk to do Nixon, Clinton, who doesn't matter? Jack Nicholson? That's the guy. All right, Uma Thurman. What do I need to say? She's the bride. She can kick ass. She looks the part. She acts the part. Amazing. And, of course, Steven Seagal as Hawkeye. We want the most dangerous man around. Somebody who, as just a human man, feels like he could kick anyone's ass. He can hang with the Captain America. He can hang with Hulk. That's Seagal, baby. And, of course, the man who holds it all together, Kevin Costner. He's got the eye patch. He is the 90s. We have to have Kevin Costner in a movie because it's the 90s.
That is a great lineup.
Solid.
Great start. Nick. Who is in your lineup?
Okay, I got Mr. 1990s, the everyone's favorite American dreamboat, Mr. Tom Cruise, box office gold, the happiest man in 90 town. He's going to represent what we want from America, a smiling, narcissistic, crazy asshole, and he's what represents 1990s America. Then we have the best character actor ever played and the fanciest rich boy that's ever been, Mr. Kevin Klein. Who doesn't want Dave to control a robot costume? And then for Thor,
Can you say who these people are playing? You're just saying names.
So far, Tom Cruise is Captain America. Okay, Kevin, yes. We have a picture now.
Kevin Klein played Thor.
And talk to the mic, please. Move the mic over. Just move your mic over right. So if you're going to stand there. Thank you.
Kevin Klein playing Iron Man.
Okay.
And then we got the most ripped dude of the 1990s. Again, pre-racism. Mr. Hulk Hogan, Mr. Body, those 24-inch pythons are straight.
As Thor.
As Thor.
I didn't know I wanted that until I saw that.
And now you want it. And then we got Hulk. And remember, guys, this is the 90s that didn't have CGI. So you need pure meat. You need pure strength. And that's why you get Shaquille O'Neal painted green. There's no special effects. He is literally painted green, and that's your Hulk. And he's also doing the title soundtrack, Avenging the Hood. He's doing the song for it.
Okay.
And then you got the biggest badass of the 1990s, Miss Gina Davis, as Black Widow.
And who's that Hawkeye?
You want a 90s movie. And I didn't see Pauly Shore in any of their picks. And that's why you get hilarities, comedies, Pauly Shore, the man who was in every movie in the 1990s, playing Hawkeye, and then you got the King of Pop, again, doing a song on the soundtrack, who can bring everyone together, who can bring everyone to a sleepover.
He'd still be alive.
Yeah, he would be alive, and he would be less creepy than what he became.
This might change him.
Michael Jackson. This might set him on a better path.
Yeah.
You got Michael Jackson playing Nick Fury.
Okay. All right, we're going to have to come back to these, obviously. Yeah. Joe, it's your turn. Let's see what your lineup is.
Thank you, gentlemen. Those are fantastic. Let's do this. My lineup, Captain America, you start with Cap. You've got Brad Pitt, okay? Steve Rogers is all about that World War II Greatest Generation jawline, and Captain America is all about getting people wet, men and women. Brad Pitt in the 90s does just that.
We know that helps Ken.
No, it absolutely helps Ken. I call this the Ken Knapsack water slide factor, and that's important for Captain America to have.
It's like a river runs through it right in the middle there.
Boom. Right there. Iron Man, ladies and gentlemen, we have the Men in Black. He is now the Man in Red and Gold. Will Smith.
Society in the 90s would not handle that well.
Dude, did I fucking vamp in your opening statement? Go shit over there, Mundy.
Hey, this is Movie Fights, not little boys crap. Ola. Keep going, comeback, sweetie. Wendy.
See if I ever save your show again. Ladies and gentlemen, following up the correct professional wrestler for this cast playing Thor, the painted one, the only, the ultimate warrior. He's huge, he's jacked, he actually thinks he's an immortal god, so just let him play one. It's absolutely perfect. Let's see here, Black Widow, Mike Carlson's correct, and Mike Carlson is one of the best movie fighters in the history of this show, and Uma Thurman, I can't argue with that, she's a fantastic choice. Hawkeye, you have the man, you have the golden boy, rising star, action hero of the 90s, pre-Crow so that he's alive. You have Brandon Lee. I am literally rewriting history so that this shoots.
Keeps him alive.
This keeps him alive. Remember that, Andy. This keeps the guy that made Rapid Fire alive, okay? And of course, Nick Fury, a bit of stunt casting, the Alec Guinness anchor for this team, Robert Redford.
Wow. Okay.
Who is the Hulk in your team, Joe?
Gary Oldman.
Gary Oldman.
Oh, Gary Oldman. Mm-hmm. I apologize. There he is back there. Gary Oldman, perfect Bruce Banner. Yeah, but he's a nutball. This gets audiences curious because he's a bad guy in the 90s. He's Mr. Bad Guy in the 90s. Now he gets to play a dark hero. Audience is going to be like, I'll pay money for that. I'll pay $7.50 for an expensive movie ticket for that.
Hmm. All right, let's start with Cap because this is going to be hard. I'm fine because I like all these pitches, surprisingly. We got Gary Sinise, Cruz, and Pitt. Quickly. Who would you knock out there, guys?
I would knock both of these guys out because they're too young and good looking. We want a Cap. Like, Chris Evans is a young, good looking, but we want a Cap who has some presence. Like we want somebody who's been on the battlefield, all right? We want somebody who has the gravitas. These are guys that are great actors. They have a great look, but Sinise is a guy that I would like to lead me into battle.
Nick?
Gary Sinise needs to worry about playing bass and sticking with his band.
He can do both, Nick.
Because I want the greatest action star of the 90s, 2000s, 2010s as Captain America. He's the guy who represents every man. He's a beautiful, sexy man, and I want to see him skinny, and then I want to turn him to Tom Cruise. When I think of Captain America, I don't think of Steve Rogers. I think of Tom Cruise.
Joe?
Guys, you want gravitas? Legends of the Fall era Brad Pitt, World War I. He charged into trenches and murdered an entire battalion because they killed his brother. This is a guy that can do pathos, and like Chris Evans, he's a good, young-looking guy. He leads you into battle, he gets you wet.
My problem with Brad Pitt at this point is his biggest credit is that arc in Growing Pains where he drank drunk drive and then hit a car and died.
Or Legends of the Fall 7, Meet Joe Black? What are you talking about?
Growing Pains.
I forget you don't watch movies, Mundy. I'm sorry, I totally forget.
I watch Growing Pains.
I mean, Tom Cruise looks like he's 15. Has anyone watched Mission Impossible 1 lately? He looks like he's 15 years old. He's great, but he looks so young. I mean, we need a guy who is at least like 10 years old. I mean, Tom Cruise is too, he still looks too young, to be quite frank.
Gary Sinise looks like pre-Super Serum Captain America. He's just some old he's just some old bitch.
Gary Sinise
looks like he's been 65 years old for 30 years
Sinise
now.
Looks like the guy you didn't want your mom to remarry.
Yeah.
Okay, he's not my Captain America.
You're thinking about 2016. Sinise. I'm thinking about prime Sinise.
No, I'm thinking about prime Sinise.
All right. And Nick gets Cap. Ooh. Iron Man. Oh. We got Raul Julia, Mike. We got Kevin Klein for Nick. And we got Will Smith for Joe. Fight. Quick.
Okay, who do you think is the fanciest, richest guy out of all these guys? It's Kevin Klein. He's been living in penthouses.
Kevin Klein.
His whole life. Kevin Klein.
Kevin Klein.
What are you talking about, Nick?
He's a fancy, debonair man who can play the smoothest guy in town. Also, he's smart as shit. And out of all of these guys, he's the only one I think could build an actual robot costume.
Tony Stark needs to be proven box office. He needs to be the backbone of this. He needs to have charisma. He needs to be funny. That's Will Smith.
That's Will Smith.
That's Men in Black. That's Bad Boys. That's Independence Day.
I don't believe that Will Smith has ever had a personal problem in his life. He's the most confident man around. We need a Tony Stark that has darkness. Will Smith has probably the greatest life, the greatest brain of all time.
Why are you going with all these old dudes? Raul Julia was already 50 years old for this.
Julia's not smart. He did Street Fighter.
He's great in Street Fighter.
Truth. Depending on when this is in the 90s, either Adams Family people are like, what? Now he's a superhero? That's Gomez Adams.
Or
he's
dead.
Done Street Fighter and he's dead and embarrassing.
We're doing the same thing with Downey. Downey was gone and now we're going to cast Raul Julia and people are like, wow, I didn't know Raul Julia could be the greatest movie star of all time.
Except Robert Downey Jr. had a drug problem. Raul Julia's dead.
Can Raul Julia...
Would Raul Julia be dead, Mike?
He would not be dead. He would be alive.
Save him?
This would save him. I would change history just like we did.
Are we allowed one history change where our decision can change?
I'm not saying he's dead. I'm saying he's an embarrassment. He's associated with Street Fighter now. Like, no one wants him to be the lead of an Avengers
film. Oh, yeah, like, you guys have never done a bad movie before.
Even in Will Smith...
Valkyrie.
Even in Wild Wild West...
Why not Will Smith, Mike?
Why now? Because he's the most confident man. We want a Tony Stark with some darkness.
Will Smith
is the most optimistic, cool, confident guy around.
Mike gets the point.
Thank you.
Well, I mean, I'm going one by one. You got Iron Man. Mike has Iron Man. So we have, so far, Tom Cruise, Raul Julia, Thor. We have Mel Gibson, Mike. We have Hulk Hogan, Nick, and Ultimate Warrior, Joe.
Night. 90s era Hulk Hogan is no longer on steroids. I am bigger than 90s era Hulk Hogan. He's not a believable Thor. He has no hair. His 24-inch pythons are 8 at best. He's not impressive. Ultimate Warrior is still a jacked up crazy roid monster. Let him scream about Odin and hit things. He won't realize he's in a movie. It'll be fucking incredible.
Ultimate Warrior never got cast in a movie because he was too busy going to Arizona State University to make videos about why homosexuals are bad people. That's what he was doing in the 1990s. And then while Hulk Hogan was making great movies
early
such as
2000s.
Suburban Commando, Mr. Nanny, and other sweet tasty dishes.
Thor with Hulk Hogan is going to need to wear a do-rag the whole movie.
Awesome! And that's even more 90s. Thank you.
Also, This is an ensemble. I want to see Will Smith interacting with Ultimate Warrior. That's insane. That's a
Will
dream.
Will Smith's already out.
Also, Ultimate Warrior gets blown up on his way to the ring. The guy can't wrestle very well, so how is he going to last 12 hours on a shoot? He can't do it. Why Mel Gibson? Because he's an amazing actor. Because we've seen him do all sorts of things. He's heroic. And he's Australian.
Here's
like
my problem
Hemsworth.
With Mel Gibson. Mel Gibson's two biggest pluses. He can sell pain great. That's useless for Thor. He doesn't sell pain. And he's super funny and witty. And Thor is not. He's sort of a big, dumb, cute oaf. Mel Gibson doesn't work for this role.
Hulk Hogan is the biggest, strongest guy. And again, you have to realize this. HGH wasn't invented then. Either were effects. You need a ripping hulking god with 24-inch pythons.
The two of these.
And a do-rag.
Both of these guys are terrible actors. They will be
horrible. Okay. Hulk Hogan's a better actor than Mel Gibson. There, I said it.
Hulk Hogan or Ultimate Warrior, Mike?
I mean, at least I've seen Thunder in Paradise, so I know Hulk can say sentences.
Nick gets the point on that round.
Woo!
All right, we're at Hulk. Robin Williams, Mike. Shaq and Green Peyton, Nick. And Gary Oldman, Joe. Who's the best Hulk here?
Here's the problem with Robin Williams. People either want to see a lot of Robin Williams and they're not going to get much Hulk, so they're going to get ripped off, or you want a lot of Hulk and you're not going to get Robin Williams, so you can't win either way.
This is the perfect amount of Robin Williams, in my opinion. If we're talking about like what the Avengers was and they used Hulk, we got a little smattering of Robin, and then we go to a different character. I think it's perfect. As far as Shaq, I mean, do we want kind of like lazy Hulk? Do we want
This is LSU... Orlando Magic Hulk, because what Hulk needs to be is the guy who can drive down into the paint and rebound and get those rebounds and like has charisma. That's Shaq. He's a big, strong, awesome, charismatic dude that loves to rap, and you need a soundtrack. And I'm sorry. Is Robin Williams doing the soundtrack? Gary Oldman doing the soundtrack?
But the heart of the Hulk is Bruce Banner, and that's Gary Oldman. He's an interesting actor. He's fun. He's a great character actor. He's got that darkness. He's a weirdo. He'll be a great scientist.
Quickly, because this is what's the one reason the other two aren't? Quickly.
Gary Sinise. He's too like
we. Gary Oldman.
Gary, excuse me. I'm confused. I'm a cockroach. Look, Gary Oldman is the 90s. He's evil. We want a Hulk that we relate to and that we like. Everyone loves Robin Williams, okay? And as far as Shaq, we have to cast Bruce Banner.
So you don't want to see Shaq in nerd glasses with his pants hiked up like Hercule?
We've seen that before.
Plus, that theme song's not a plus. I've heard Shaq rap.
Why
that's
not
a terrible
Robin
idea.
Williams, Joe?
Why not? Like I said, it's just too much. You either want just nonstop Robin Williams or you want Hulk, and you can't have both.
All right, Gary Oldman is our Hulk. Black Widow, I'm just giving it to Uma Thurman. You both get points.
What the shit?
I think that was a really good call.
Gina,
you both picked it.
Gina Davis?
It's fair, but I just think that great minds thought alike.
She was in Cutthroat Island. She's been through enough.
All right, so Hawkeye. We have Seagal.
You're all dead.
We have Seagal as Hawkeye. Pauly Shore for Nick. And we have Brandon Lee.
It's a 90s movie. It's a 90s movie. You need
Pauly
Shore.
It's a 90s movie.
It's a 90s movie. It's a 90s movie. It's a 90s movie.
Okay?
All right.
Make a decision. Make a decision, Andy.
All right, you all get the point.
Yeah!
All right, we have three Hawkeyes. All right, Nick Fury, this is the deciding vote right here. Kevin Costner, Mike, Nick, Michael Jackson, Joe, Robert Redford.
Okay, when I want to see a big action-packed blockbuster movie, I don't want Kevin Costner ruining it, because that's what he did in the 90s. I want to see the king of pop. I want to see a mysterious, elusive man who can sneak into the shadows and bring people together.
Disregard anything Nick Mundy has said, because how dare you besmirch the Mariner? But I will not go with Kevin Costner, because this is Kevin Costner at the height of his powers. There's no way he plays second supporting fiddle to this ensemble. It just won't work.
Why would Redford do that?
Redford,
Redford's been lying second low. Fiddle either.
Redford's been lying low in the 90s. He's looking for a good comeback.
He didn't
he's
have
looking
a job.
For a way in. He didn't have a job. He's the Alec Guinness.
Redford
he's coming
would
in.
Never
he's going to be the
superhero
respect
crap.
Factor.
He's old now, and his kids, super grandkids wanted him to do it. That's the only reason we got him in Winter Soldier.
He was box office poison, and I don't want Kevin Costner to ruin another movie.
No.
Brandon Lee is too good of a fighter. He's Bruce Lee's kid.
Hawkeye. Kevin Costner, Michael Jackson, and Rebel Redford.
Michael Jackson. Talk shit on Michael Jackson. Talk shit on Michael Jackson.
Also a good fighter.
Can you talk shit on Michael Jackson?
Yeah, I can. Captain EO. I love Captain EO, but the line readings in Captain EO are the worst I've ever heard.
Worse than Samuel L. Jackson? Sleepwalking through all the movies?
Well, but that's fine. He's Sam Jackson.
You want to complain about line readings? Let's go with the greatest actor in this bunch, Robert Redford. Let's give it to Jay Gatsby.
That movie sucked. Michael Jackson's a better actor than Robert Redford. It's a king of pop.
Okay. You just got so much silence from the whole table.
I need someone to say something here. Helpful.
Kevin Costner in Man of Steel gave Superman some of the worst advice I've ever heard, and he sold it like a champion. We want a guy that will lead us into battle and will believe what we're saying.
I heard your final thoughts plenty. Joe?
Robert Redford is the best actor of the bunch. He gives this group a classic respected actor as an anchor, and he did not make The Postman.
Do you want a rhinestone eye patch?
All right, as I really, you all three were tied on your, because that's how I did this. I gave circles to the points your all through, and so it came down to Nick Fury. It was 3-3-3, so the winner of Nick Fury is going to win. Before I call it, Dan, anything you'd like to add?
Does it matter? No, I'm fine.
I got very confused during this.
Can we?
It's a hard thing to do.
Can we throw up Joe's pick, Brad Pitt as Cap, and Will Smith as Iron Man? JT's, we're all waiting for you. That's good. Joe gets the points!
Thank you, sir.
Made a very good argument there at the end. Rob Redford put you over the edge. And I thought, actually, Brandon Lee was a good call. You had Uma. It was all in all a good batch. It was three good batches. I had no other way to do it. Joe's on the board first.
Thank you. I mean, this is a Neapolitan. These are all good flavors.
All right, guys. Can you believe we're going six rounds today?
Yeah.
6 out of 9.
Okay. We used to go six, right?
We're going weird today.
Yeah.
The fans didn't even realize. See what we give you guys?
Belt fight.
It's going to be like a 2-hour fight. I'm worried. Yeah.
Weird fight.
Six rounds. Belt fight 5. All right. Round 2. This comes in from Tom Sitch on Facebook, who reached out and said he wants to lean into your strengths, which is hilarious pitches. So, we'd like you guys to pitch a fast food franchise as a movie franchise. So please pick a fast food restaurant or food franchise and turn it into a movie franchise. Nick, you're up first. What are you picking?
Okay, this is an erotic thriller.
And if you're watching along, make sure you're tuning into hashtag Movie Fights Live. Right, Dan? Thank you.
Yes.
Did we have a poll in that last one somehow?
We did somehow. I don't know how. I don't know. But Nick's team actually had 38% of the vote. Mike's had 35%, and Joe's had 27% of the fan.
All right. Sorry, go ahead.
27.
Nick, you're going
like
for
Trump numbers. You got Trump numbers.
What is your fast food franchise you turn into a movie franchise?
Yeah, I'm going to take Jack from Jack in a Box, a rich, lonely man who has, he has one emotion, that smile face, and it can't, that's the only emotion he has, and he can't change because he's experienced.
Why is there a Carl's Jr. behind him? Sorry.
Because
yeah. Really bad ass.
Because JT's an asshole.
Sorry, keep going.
He's a rich, debonair man who has this one emotion on his face, and he wants to experience pleasure and pain and all these feelings. So what he does is he brings sexual partners to his box. A room rich with BDSM materials, and he tries to use them to change his reaction on his face, and it doesn't work until he met a lonely, lonely fry chef at one of his restaurants who challenged him not only sexually, but very sexually and emotionally and sexually. And also, Jack is finally going to get into a box that he loves. But still, he has to, like, have all these trappings of a rich, fancy bondage freak. And it's the story of a man changing.
All right, Joe, you're up next. What fast food franchise are you turning into a movie franchise?
In 2002, the heart, face, and soul of Wendy's, Dave Thomas, passed away. It took out the heart of America. It was like losing a grandfather. No one felt it stronger than his daughter, Melinda Liu, because no one but Melinda knew that her father had been murdered. Where's the beef? She's got some. This summer, revenge is a dish best served frosty. Melinda was expected to take over the family business and step into the mantle of Wendy Thomas, but earning the name Wendy meant revenge for her father first. Before she can serve Baconators, she has to go. Terminator. In the spirit of grindhouse cult classics like Pam Grier's Coffee, Rolling Thunder starring Tommy Lee Jones, and the Mariachi Trilogy, this one-woman road to revenge is Rodriguez and Tarantino by way of Russ Meyer and Roger Corman, directed by a returning John Carpenter on a shoestring budget, produced by Sam Raimi and starring Alexandra Daddario as Wendy. The patties might be square, but she's all curves.
Can you do honest trailers from now on?
Sure, I'm around.
Yeah, okay, cool.
Oh, you really got me with the Dario as Wendy. Wow,
hey.
Good casting there. All right, Mike, what's yours?
All right, there are a set of characters that have been overlooked by Hollywood for decades now. These are characters that are beloved to me. Some people think I'm being funny. I'm not. I'm dead serious. I'm talking about the Chuck E. Cheese characters. All right, I'm talking about
Jesus.
There's Chuck E. Cheese. Do we have any graphics of his other friends or no?
Gang? Oh, come on. There's a gang. Where's Munch?
There's a gang. Yes, that's what we're getting to.
At least you have a Carl's Jr. behind it.
All right. This is a Chuck E. Cheese origin story. All right, now, as you know, everyone's been to a Chuck E. Cheese. Chuck E. Cheese has a band. It's called Munch's Make Believe Band. Munch is a giant, hairy, purple character from some sort of planet that I assume is called
the planet. He's a grimace, right?
Don't say that. That's offensive.
I'll try to provide pictures.
Yes, he's from what I assume is like a planet purple. We'll say that. This is an origin story of Chuck E. Cheese. Chuck E. Cheese is down on his luck. He owns a diner. It's not going well. Business is not good. He goes to a local watering hole. Now, this is a kid's movie, so it's not a bar. It's a cheese bar. He's eating different kinds of cheeses. There's a local indie band.
It is important that it's a kid's movie.
Yes. Munch's Make-Believe Band is what it's called. Let's get a picture of these guys right here. Now, let's go over the characters, all right? You switched.
Hold on. Sorry.
Okay, sorry. You're getting a better picture?
No, yeah, sorry.
Okay.
Keep talking.
All right. We have Pasquale, the Italian pizza chef who plays drums. We have Jasper T. Jowles, the dog who plays the guitar. We have Helen, who plays, is just on the vocals. And we have Munch, who plays the keyboard, and he sings. This is Munch's Make-Believe Band. This is the origin story. Now, we're talking about launching a franchise. That was the question, not just a movie. These are characters that can be spun out into their own movies, trilogies of movies. We want to see Munch go back to the planet purple. He's going to have a whole adventure. We want to see Pasquale go back to the country. We want to see him meet his mom and dad. That's Pasquale, obviously. He's the Italian pizza chef. That is Jasper T. Jowles.
That's Munch.
We want to see a movie where Billy Ray Cyrus and Jasper T. Jowles team up. I'm not just thinking money. I'm one movie here. I'm thinking franchise. These characters are ripe. Come on, Hollywood. Let's make it happen.
Okay.
All right. I'm going to ignore the children's movie and focus on the Paul Verhoeven trilogy of erotica featuring a man getting probed, prodded, filleted, other stuff, and trying to change his face. I want to see Jack get banged. And I think everyone does in a classy,
erotic
thriller.
Do you think, guys, do you all want to see that?
No, I don't want to see that.
In fact, I think it's...
Who would want to see that?
Why wouldn't you want to see that?
I think it says so much that the first thing we noticed was a background Carl's Jr. picture in that sign. I don't care about Jack. It was a giant picture of him, and that sign was the
Jack is a regional chain, by the way. Jack's
regional
a regional chain. I didn't know Jack was growing up. I heard maybe in a movie, and I went, what's that? I don't care, and I especially don't care about seeing him in sexual exploits.
Jack is the best mascot of any...
Best mascot?
Of any restaurant.
Negative.
No.
Okay. By the way, I look like Dave Thomas, and I don't give a shit about your movie. Like, it's just like, oh, it's another grindhouse movie. Like, and I'm confused. Is it Wendy or is it the actual Dave Thomas's daughter?
They're the same person. She plays the character of Wendy.
I couldn't tell. I was just focusing on like the.
Here's the thing about movie. It's this franchise. This path of revenge is all real life stuff. Who killed Dave Thomas? Was it Colonel Sanders? Because Thomas got KFC on the map. Was it Shady Dealings and the Dave Thomas Foundation for adoption? Was it someone connected to his time as an army cook in the Korean War? This is going to be a global path of destruction. It's going to be a trail of bodies. Okay. She has to earn the name Wendy, and to earn it, she has to make people fear the name Wendy.
This is a perversion of these beloved characters, all right? We don't need to lean on the American sex and violence. We want to have a good old-fashioned time at the cinema, okay? Seeing animals play instruments, sing songs about birthday cake. You know, that's what we want. We do not need to see this grotesque perversion of...
No. You want to talk about grotesque perversion. The Rockefeller explosion got an entire documentary, and I needed to take a shower after every 15 minutes of it. It made me feel so gross and weird.
Look, that's an error, because this is not the Rockefeller explosion. That is a different band.
By the way, this is a knockoff band.
Isn't it weird that Chuck E. Cheese isn't the lead of his own band?
No, it's not, because he's the manager. He has a restaurant to manage, Nick.
Guys,
he has a restaurant to manage, and he goes up and sings once in a while.
So you're
okay?
picking the Grimace. Like, you're not picking Ronald McDonald. You're picking the Grimace.
Mike,
of the
I
Chuck
respect you so much, and you've just pitched me the Country Bears. You pitched me Jem and the Holograms. These are failures of films.
And Joe,
yes,
I have a question for you.
Done right.
Joe, I have a question for
Ask
you.
Ask me, Nick.
When was the last time you drove up and got drive-through at a Chuck E. Cheese, indicating that it was a fast food restaurant?
There it is.
That's completely fair. I mean, that is completely fair.
No, but what I like to do is I like to drive up to Jack in the Box, get some fast food, and I want Jack to get blown, and I want to see some Jack in some boxes.
You can get a pizza to go at Chuck E. Cheese, okay?
That's not fast
Little
food.
Little Caesars is a fast food place. Chuck E. Cheese, pizza. These are fast food places. They have things
hot and ready.
You just have to get
your hand stamped, right?
Guys, it helps if you do that. You don't have to, depending on what the location is.
Alexander Daddario cutting a man down with a katana sword because he may have killed Dave Thomas for being furious that Dave introduced the concept of the 99-cent menu. Okay? Fear the name Wendy. These movies will cost nothing. They will make tons. They could go on forever. They're going to be cult classics.
I'll tell you this. These will destroy two beloved franchises that I happen to eat at regularly. Maybe once or twice a week. If these movies come out, they will sink.
At least people know who
entire,
people are.
Oh, people don't know who Munch is. What are you even saying?
I don't know who that is. I thought it was a Chuck E.
Hashtag
Cheese
Hashtag Munch. Let's send
Hashtag
it in.
Hashtag Munch.
By the way, how many times are you going to Chuck E. Cheese a week?
Not many.
You know who's more
believable?
You don't
have kids, right?
Not yet.
You know who I buy
I'm
into more having a sex dungeon than Jack? Every cast member in Mike's gross, creepy animatronic movie.
I'm the star of this movie, also.
So am I.
Right. Dan?
Yes.
Anything to add there?
I mean, again, does it matter? Okay, here's what I will say.
Yes.
The Rockefeller explosion was the, I know this because I experienced it, was the showbiz pizza ban
when
Billy Bob was in charge. After there's a managerial change and Chuck E. Cheese took over, that's when the Munch's band took over.
So. Oh, yeah, and these things weren't weirdly connected at all.
Well, it's very controversial. Some people like Rockefeller better.
This is like
McDaniels
versus McDonald's. We got the golden arcs.
No way. The personality of the Chuck E. Cheese character.
Our bun has
better.
No seeds.
I will say, I can't find definitive, but I will say that in the wiki of fast food franchises, Chuck E. Cheese is listed as a fast food franchise.
Of course.
I think that's horseshit.
Of course.
But again, I don't know if there is a definitive source.
You walk
to get
in
that
with a bunch of tickets, you can get a prize real quick. You're out.
Yeah, other than that, I literally have nothing.
Wait,
I do want to fact check Nick. This is Dave Thomas from Wendy's. And
he looks nothing like
absolutely
him.
Nothing like Dave Thomas from
with
Wendy's.
The wig.
No,
not even.
So.
Give me your glasses.
Not even close. No. Still
right.
Wouldn't
well,
work.
Good. Old fuck.
Okay.
Well, you said it.
You said it. Pete, which of these movie franchises would you prefer to see?
Well, I think Joe had a really good pitch, but considering this is weird movie fights, I may have to lean toward Nick because that was definitely the weirdest.
Ooh, interesting
that's
switch.
Fair. Yeah, that's fair.
Well, it is weird movie fights, but it's still movie fights. So I make the call, and I think Joe's is still weird, and I like that you made some strong arguments there. I got to keep some sanity here. Joe's gets a second point.
Thank you. And that is the weirdest thing of all.
I love that you knocked down and knew the other band, and yeah, there was plenty of knowledge that he was dropping. But yes, Pete is correct. Nick won for the weirdest thing.
Which was the point of the show.
But let's still make this about a good fight. No, it's still movie fights.
It is currently neck and neck on Twitter. 41% Chuck E. Cheese, 38% Wendy's. Jack in the Box has 21%, but it is a neck and neck right now with the fans between Mike and Joe.
I had to go on the arguments on that one.
They're all afraid of their sexuality.
Loses.
Round three. Guys, now that Helen Mirren has joined Furious 8, which Fast and the Furious character should be her love interest? Starting with you, Joe, who should Helen Mirren bang in the Fast and the Furious movies?
Guys, the question about love interests in the Furious franchise is who really needs one. What feels logical, what feels organic. The cars, the action, none of that needs to be logical, but I feel like who F's who should be. The only answer here is Roman, played by Tyrese. I think we can all agree that Too Fast, Too Furious was a movie about Tyrese and Paul Walker being intensely in love with each other. I don't think anyone would argue that. Obviously, the masculine underworld they operated in wouldn't allow that relationship to blossom, so it was an unrequited love, and by the time they reunited, Paul Walker was with Dom's sister and then died. That's a deep depression, and it's going to take a woman like Helen Mirren to pull Tyrese out of that. This is a character who needs this story. This is a character who needs this angle. Both of them will be better. And also, I feel like Tyrese and Helen Mirren just fucking on top of a Honda Civic will be really cool.
So you want to focus
on... Hold on, Nick. Mike. Save your thought. We'll get there. Mike.
I'm going to go with Michelle Rodriguez's character, Letty. Now, she's been through a lot in these movies.
That just smacked me in the face.
I'm so sorry, but my antenna go everywhere. She's been through a lot. She's been evil. She's lost her memory. But at the end of the last movie, she's sort of back with Vin Diesel, but like she doesn't fully have the memories back, okay? So maybe they split up. Maybe she, while she was evil, she took a older lady as a lover. Very possible. Don't you think that's more interesting than what Nick will say or what Joe just said? Also, all kidding aside, let's just get a gay couple in one of these movies, folks. Come on.
Well, I do appreciate, before you even said that, you made both of these people break, and I'm going to admit it. Go ahead, Nick.
I have just three things to say. One, you want to focus on the worst character from the worst Fast and the Furious movie, Tyrese. You want to focus on the second worst character, and you want to break up Vin Diesel and Michelle Rodriguez, the only thing that makes Vin Diesel happy. And then I'm going to say something that I'm so confident in, I'm not going to say anything else this round. I want Helen Mirren with Ludacris, because that gets us closer to a Helen Mirren being in a Ludacris music video.
Will you see yourself out?
Look, Ludacris might have so much diamonds on his chest, it's like there's a midget around his neck. But I mean, I don't care about the music video. I care about the integrity of these films. And Tyrese's character is a character that this is a character that needs somewhere to go. Everyone else has had their arcs and directions. Someone needs to step up into Paul Walker's shoes, and I think it's Tyrese. He is.
You shut your goddamn mouth.
Saw yourself out, Mundy.
I know, but you said something that you can't take back. You said something that you can't take back.
That Paul Walker died?
No, well, no, I knew that.
Because he hasn't. Sorry, I watched a lot of InfoWars.
I'm sorry. Oh, Alex Jones, okay.
Yeah.
Here's a war into itself. Tyrese is not the new Paul Walker, my friend.
He can be. He has that potential.
I'm going to go back.
Okay, these are two...
What is happening?
I don't know. This is very weird. This is weirder than even Cockroach Boy thought it would be. Folks, this is something... We want something that's interesting, that's going to give us an interesting storyline. This is something that we could say, like, oh, Helen Mirren and Michelle Rodriguez had a relationship while she forgot her memory. This is something that can come back into play and give us, like, an interesting storyline. These two things would be, like, fun, I guess. And everyone's talking about, like, the integrity and the good characters of this. These movies are fun, but I don't know if that even makes sense. I'm looking for something that's more interesting and something we haven't seen before. This is a fully new thing in a big blockbuster movie.
Mike gets the point.
I'm gonna see Helen Mirren in a Breton.
I can sit there. We can sit about it more. But you made them both laugh. They're not even admitting it, but you did.
Oh, I'll admit it. Mike Ross is one of the funniest people I've ever met in my life.
Funniest fucking guy.
I'll admit that.
Funniest Mike gets it. Good job.
So kind. Thank you.
All right, you round four. All right, guys. Central Intelligence is coming out this weekend, and we can't not talk about The Rock. No. We have to do a Rock question. Nick's here. He's friends with The Rock. So this comes from our friend Jack Shipley on Facebook. The year is 1995. Dwayne Johnson has just graduated college and is about to begin training as a professional wrestler. In a twist of fate, he instead is cast in his first movie instead of wrestling. So, which 1995-1996 movie role would have been better with The Rock as a lead? All right, and you're up first, Mike.
Showgirls. Showgirls is regarded as one of the worst movies, if not the worst movie ever made. And if we put a very young Rock in this movie, it would make it 100 times better. Now, here's the thing. We can keep almost everything the same, and it would be so much better. He can still be called Naomi Malone. That could be a dude's name. We don't know.
So he is Showgirl.
Yes, we can call it Showgirl. I mean, whatever. That's yeah.
No, but no. What I'm saying is, he's not Kyle MacLachlan's character.
No, he is Elizabeth Berkley.
Okay, thank you. Yes. I just want to make sure
we can call. Okay, Showboy. We'll call it Showboy.
Ooh, I like that.
And he's auditioning probably for something like Thunder Death from Down Under, which is that sexy all Australian men, or right. Supposedly. We don't know all the accents,
good.
But that's great. Yeah, they're all handsome and they have big chests. And he's auditioning for that, of course. So it's pretty much the same plot of the movie. He pushes somebody down the stairs to try to get ahead. The director of Thunder from Down Under humiliates him by putting ice on his nipples and making his nipples hard during the audition process. It's the same movie. All of these things, though, now have The Rock in it. I want you to remember, The Rock is not going to be his full Rock self because he hasn't had these years of wrestling. So we want a guy who's a little bit vulnerable, a little bit unsure of himself, and that's going to be a perfect role for Rock.
Except I can't see Kyle MacLachlan banging the hell out of him under a cool waterfall.
Same.
I can.
Honestly, yeah, I can too.
Does Kyle MacLachlan bang him, or would you recast
they bang.
Him?
Of course they bang.
Oh, that's shot for shot the same.
Yeah,
probably.
Yeah, it's the same thing.
Of course.
And then Robert Davi is sexually harassing him?
The same thing.
Okay.
Okay, Nick.
You can't argue with
it. What movie are you picking?
Well, speaking of Jack Shipley, this is a tribute to you that I just realized is a coincidence. I'm picking the Sad Bastard movie Jack. It's one of Robin Williams.
Is that a
backhanded shout out.
Yeah, it's a.
You didn't mean that.
No,
Jack,
I didn't.
Love you, Jack.
No, Jack is a terrible movie that could have been great, and it's a real like sad, sappy movie about a 10-year-old who his body grows really fast and he turns into an old man. Well, I don't want sad like indie movie Robin Williams. I want The Rock. What 10-year-old wouldn't want to become The Rock? How great would that be? It would be a drama. It would be like this action comedy. It would be this badass movie that any 10-year-old would want to become into The Rock. Think about all the girls you can get. Think about the clubs you can get into. Think about the fights you can do. You could do anything you wanted to if you were The Rock. And it's a wish fulfillment movie. Who doesn't want to be The Rock in general? And this movie fulfills that dream. And it doesn't worry about that whole disease that's killing him. We don't worry about that because he's The Rock and he's handsome. And who wouldn't want to be him in that situation?
Okay, Joe?
Guys, this 1996 classic has everything going for it save one thing. A massively charismatic rookie action star as its lead. Featuring Jason Isaacs as an evil lord, the rough and tumble and beautiful Dina Meyer of Starship Troopers fame as a love interest, and a giant dragon voiced by Sean Connery. Ladies and gentlemen, there's no better home for the man that would become The Rock, Dwayne Johnson, than the movie Dragonheart. That is beautiful. God, look, I would watch that right now. Can we stop the fight so I can watch this movie?
I do kind of want to see Dragonheart again. I don't know if I want to see your movie yet. Let's hear more about it. Go ahead, guys, fight.
You know, I saw a better version of that movie in Scorpion King. He's fine. I don't need to see, like, a shitty, like, Randy Quaid movie.
Doesn't exist in this universe. He's already The Rock when he did Scorpion King. You had to fundamentally change the movie Jack to fit him into this movie.
No, it becomes fundamentally better. Who would you rather grow into? Robin Williams? Like, sad Robin Williams. We're not going to be a funny Robin Williams. Or would you rather grow into The Rock? Like, as a 10-year-old, who would you rather be? Honestly, you would rather
you
be
guys
The Rock.
Can ask her to answer that?
I don't think
The Rock, but I don't know what that.
Yeah, I don't know.
No, it's a fun wish fulfillment movie. It makes a terrible movie great. Your movie is already terrible, and it doesn't make it that much better because The Rock's not the dragon.
No. This
you
is classic.
The wrong part.
This
you
is,
picked the wrong part.
No, because The Rock cannot carry a movie yet. He's not The Rock yet. He's babyface, bright-eyed, bushy-tail, Peter Rocky Maivia right now.
See, I
now,
believe in him already.
Okay?
He was The Rock in Miami.
He needs a strong anchor to play off of, a mentor, and that's Sean Connery, who absolutely would be on set because he's Sean Connery. He's a class act.
He wasn't on set. He was doing the lines from an ISDN line from his home.
Absolutely
not. He did
not
show up on set once.
How dare you besmirch
he
him?
He would show up on set.
He was 90s. It was 90. This movie almost.
He cared about this project. He would absolutely show up. He's not The Rock yet. He's not cocky. So you need that fire from Idina Meyer to bring it out of him.
I guess you didn't watch him in Miami.
Look, this guy, he's done Scorpion King, he's done Hercules, he kills at B-level sword and sorcery. This would be a fantastic movie with The Rock in it.
These movies are all garbage. All three of these movies are garbage. They're terrible, okay? But what is let's think about this. What is the one you want to watch of the three and then add The Rock to it?
Well,
Showgirls. Most watchable of the three movies.
No.
Not Dragonheart. Showgirls.
To quote Showgirls.
I don't want to see Rock go through his period and then lick his fingers. I don't want
to
see that.
To quote Showgirls, when I drink champagne, I always watch Dragonheart featuring The Rock. Nick's Jack isn't even in this conversation. This is you and me, Carlson.
What?
Yeah. You haven't sold this movie yet.
No, you haven't. He's right. You're out of this competition.
You motherfuckers. Yeah. This is the only question that makes sense. Jack is the only one that works. Have you guys
all
seen
Nick,
Jack?
Shut up.
My fundamental issue with Showgirls is you have now. I think you've irreparably damaged the relationship between Gina Gershon and Nomi. Because that's like a big point of this. Now it's just another dude banging chick instead of their weird like Fatal Attraction lesbian.
Well, dude banging a dude, right?
It's gonna be Gina Gershon is a dude in this.
Oh, okay. Played by who? Just out of curiosity.
Oh, play Sean Connery.
Well played, sir. Absolutely well played. But look.
Well, Joe's out.
No, I think Joe's out. I just sealed that one for him. So. We're going.
Oh, I broke character.
2-2. Nick, you got to get on the board.
Mike gets the point.
Mike got the point, I think. How'd they say on the polls there?
Oh. Showgirls right now has 38%. These things are going so fast that the polls are barely getting out before the rounds are over. But right now, Showgirls has 38%. Dragonheart has 37%. Jack has 25%.
Wow, it's close.
Well, we got two
more
rounds
right now.
We got plenty of time, and I want to leave some time for these rounds too. Here we go, guys. I'm excited for this round five. This one comes from one of Screen Junkies' biggest fans, Mike Carlson himself. He wants us to pitch Cars 6. Now, I want you guys to keep in mind the characters must have made progress through three other movies. For this pitch. So keep that in mind when you're pitching me. That's important. I'm listening to that. This is not Cars 3. This is Cars 6. Everyone understand? And I think we actually had some fans make some visual aids for you guys. There's a still from your film and a poster. So as you're talking, you can cue those up if you like. And Nick, you're up first.
Well, the cute, wonderful world of the mediocre Cars movies is over. Oil is gone. It's scarce. Welcome to the Mad Max hellscape of Car 6 Carmageddon. And now cars are literally murdering each other. You want some division? Mater and what's the other character's name? McCool?
Sean Connery.
Yeah, Sean Connery. They hate each other. They're on opposite ends of a warring faction trying to murder and steal and trying to get as much oil as possible. This whole, like, friendship Pixar thing went to hell, and now these cars are doing what they're supposed to do, kill, smash, and be deadly machines like they should have been from the beginning. This is Carmageddon.
All right, Joe.
After introducing the world of Cars, expanding it with a spy story in Cars 2, defending the world against an army of monster cars in a galactic Grand Prix race with the help of a legendary racing car voiced by Michael Jordan in Cars 3, bringing it down a few pegs with a quiet and reflective road trip with a spiritual mentor called Grand Cherokee tests the bond between Lightning and Mater in Cars 4, The Thin White Dotted Line, directed by Terrence Malick. And finally returning to classic Cars form in Cars 5, it's basically Cars 1 again, but also The Rock is in it this time. The characters of Cars are in for the adventure of their lives in Cars 6, Civil Wheels, Dodge of Justice. When an evil industrialist named Max Lexus pits Lightning and Mater against each other by pinning the blame on a major parking garage explosion on Mater's European spy friends from Cars 2, the world of Cars is primed for civil war as these two heroes and their allies clash. Everything in Cars has been building to this, because you wouldn't make a movie about your marquee characters fighting the second movie of your franchise, right? Because that would be dumb.
Ooh. Mike.
Hybrid. CGI human beings. We open the first scene, Elon Musk, the year 2016. Elon Musk says, "Ladies and gentlemen, I am showing you the first ever self-driving car, fully autonomous." He pulls the thing back. It's Mater underneath. Mater is the first self-driving car. Something is afoot. Something is strange. Now we go to the car's world. Mater's children, Tailpipe and Mater Jr., where did Dad go? Dad doesn't usually go out for this long. He goes, he talks to Lightning McQueen's kids, and Lightning McQueen, they have to figure something out. So they run into a new character I've created named Delory, who is a female car, who's a DeLorean. And she She can time travel and go through dimensions. She tells us Mater's been taken by evil Elon Musk, and we have to go to the human world and get him. And that's when the adventure begins. Also, they've had kids, so that's what happened in the last three movies.
There's a poster.
Mm-hmm. Is that a Stargate?
That's apparently a Stargate. I'll add that to the pitch, sure. Delory actually lives in a garage that is a Stargate.
Cool.
Yeah, right. It's great.
That's fair. All right, guys.
Look.
I want to make sure the polls are up for Carmageddon, The New World, and Civil Wheels Dodge of Justice, because I'm going to ask the Pete and the viewers at home which one they want to see. Go ahead, start pitching this to the crowd.
Yeah. Go for it.
Oh, sure. See, I have real stakes. All your favorite cars are forced to choose a side. Doc Hudson, Sarge, Finn McMissile, Holly Shiftwell, the telepathic recluse from the fourth movie called Scion, the Rock's fan favorite guitar-playing military vehicle Strum-V, and introducing in this film, Spider-Car, voiced by Donald Glover. Spider-Man has a car in the comics. We're bringing it into the Cars-verse. The point of these movies
the
is to sell plastic to dumb children. The internet doesn't care about cars. Babies that love Hot Wheels care about cars. We're going to give them millions of them.
This is a cynical cash grab, all right? This is something
Absolutely.
That's just thinking about toys.
Cash grab.
I believe in the heart and soul of the Cars movies. I'm taking it in an interesting direction that has real world. I'm trying to say something about the real world. We're talking about cars. That is something that's actually going to happen soon, okay? I am not only telling an entertaining story with Mater, Lightning McQueen, and all of his friends, but I'm also making a point about the dangers of having computers drive our cars for us.
And here's the thing. You want to talk about change, character change. Here's the thing I saw in that Cars movie. Dieter? What's his name? Like,
from Sprocket?
Larry the Cable
Guy. The Mike Myers
character from Sprocket. Mater. Larry the Cable Guy. I hate Larry the Cable Guy. Everyone hates Larry the Cable Guy. No one likes Mater. He is the vicious warlord trying to suck up the oil. He has finally turned heel, ladies
Kids
and gentlemen.
Kids love Mater. He sounds funny.
This is blasphemy.
He sounds funny.
This is like John Cena turning heel. Mater is one of the most beloved characters
happen.
Of all
exactly.
time. His line to California
exactly.
Adventure is so long, I can never,
no,
I don't
no.
want to wait that long.
And then this
long.
Is a movie about what is going to happen. You want to talk about a real world movie that happens? This is what's going to happen to our world when we're out of resources.
I don't care
lesson.
About the real
it's
world.
Lesson.
In Cars Talk movie, Andy, my problem is neither of these guys have given us the progression in the franchise to get to where they are. I have.
It is a good point. Do you
in
guys
this
have
franchise,
a progression you can share quickly?
The Cars have saved the world. They've worked together as a team. They've had their friendships tested by Terrence Malick. They've come together. They've been torn apart.
Just rip it off other movies.
The cliffhanger of this film. Can the Cars discover that the real threat is an army of monster trucks built by Lexus and the evil General Motors with the evil, evil Vanos waiting in the wings. Okay?
Cars 3, we have babies.
Oh,
Cars
now he's doing
4,
it. Okay.
Cars in space. Cars 5, cars are back on Earth.
Cars 3, they make love. We see it, every detail. Cars 4, they go back in time and develop the first car, and they stop Kennedy from getting killed. You're welcome. The Lincoln Kennedy car. 5, they go back into time. They see the God hand. They see creation happen. And they wonder why they were created. And they learn the final truth, which leads us to Car 6, where it's Carmageddon. Everyone's dead. And they're all killing each other because these things are goddamn cars. They're not humans. They don't have souls. And they're ripping each other apart.
Guys,
in
the
a
Cars
glory
franchise.
Of wanton destruction.
The villains of this piece should not be the cars. The cars are pure and innocent. The villains of the piece should be humans. We are the ones that lead to this planet's destruction.
Absolutely disagree. The villains of cars should be ridiculous mustachio-twirling cars with stupid voices. That's who
the villains
of these
should
films
be themselves
be.
Because we're all villains and we're all heroes and we're going to let society decide which is which. And these kids, when they first saw this movie, they were like 2 or 3. They're probably, but when Car 6 comes out in 10 years, they're probably going to be angry 18-year-olds who just want to see cars beat the shit out of each other and watch the world burn.
Andy, I'm shutting this down. This movie is giving you a Spider-Man car voiced by Donald Glover, which the internet will fucking love, by the way. Don't you ever tell me
the internet
will
love
that.
They loved the
Donald Glover.
They
loved it 5 years
ago.
They're going on about it again. Everyone's like, is he Miles Morales in the new movie? I'm also giving you a guitar-playing rock Humvee, Adam, named Strum-V. That is the best thing you have ever heard in your life, and you know it.
They stopped Kennedy from getting killed.
Delory.
You didn't earn that Kennedy assassination prevention.
All right. Nah, Dan over there.
Unfortunately,
the
no one did.
No one did.
Yeah, the poll's up. I could let you know whenever you'd like
okay,
to
Okay, but we have the poll up.
There's the poll up.
Anything you'd like to add there?
Nope.
Pete, what do you like out of those movies?
I really like Nick's pitch of Carmageddon.
I like this guy. Strong Hal is awesome.
All right.
Strong Hal. Muscles Hal.
Hey, Hal, I mean, he's
Hal
strong.
Is strong.
He's strong.
Too,
Hal is strong, too, though.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Don't knock Hal's muscles.
I'm stronger.
All right.
I like Pete. Pete's got...
I gotta say, this is weird movie fights. This was a very weird round. But someone got really passionate, and I just got to give him props. We got to go a little weird, and the Lincoln car or the God hand. I mean, he went to places I didn't think he could go. Nick Mundy gets the point.
That's fair.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah, that's fair.
Woo! I've never seen Cars.
Yeah, that's pretty obvious.
I didn't know the car. I didn't know the names. Doesn't matter.
Calling a dealer. You know, calling a dealer was pretty good.
You can look those things up on the internet.
You still won. On the internet.
No, because I got to worry about the next question.
You look like you've been holding four cats.
I am. How'd the poll online go, Dan?
Nick was the winner of the online poll.
Yeah, wow. It was a good title, too.
People like the word God hand. Let that be a lesson in your papers and homework, kid.
Yeah.
Teachers like God hand.
Wow. We're trucking along this episode.
Oh, this one's going to take a while. And because we're going to be respectful.
Round six. Bonus. 6 out of 9 in honor of these players. Thomas Pulford submitted this question on my Facebook page, and it's a perfect fit for today's show. Which two movie characters would have the best sex scene? Now, you can pick any two characters you want from any movies, but which ones would have the best sex scene? Now, we're going to start with you, Joe.
Starting with me? All right. We're taking our time with this?
Yeah.
Okay. Guys, we're not talking about the weirdest sex scene.
Oh, sorry. Can I go back and can I thank Michael Bates for those posters?
Those were great.
At Pygmy Warrior. We had some stills that we'll show after the fight.
I was so crazy. I didn't even look at mine.
From Jake A. At Fowl on Twitter. We'll show them after the fight on Plus. Go ahead.
Guys, we're not talking about the weirdest sex scene. We're not talking about the biggest sex scene. We're talking about the best sex scene that the film industry and our imaginations could possibly offer. And when you want the best sex, you turn to two people. You turn to Lando Calrissian, the space gambler turned Baron Administrator of Cloud City, and you turn to sociopathic Black Widow / best-selling crime writer Catherine Tremell, played by the legendary Sharon Stone in the greatest gift to 90s puberty, the film Basic Instinct. A great movie sex scene needs stakes and it needs character. Otherwise, you can just watch porn, and that is not what this is about. Lando's doing his best to play for the Angels, but he's got some darkness in him. Catherine Tremell is nothing but darkness, and the idea of seducing a high-profile man like Lando would be incredibly appealing and sexy to her. We're talking about anticipation. We're talking about suspense. We're talking about sexy.
Whew. Mike.
All right, I'm going to go with, some people probably think this is pretty obvious, I'm going to go with the Megazord versus Mechagodzilla.
That was my first pick, and I
when I say versus,
off.
I mean, of course, lovemaking. Folks, this is a robot and another robot. And I, of course, have written one page of the script for how this would go. And I'm going to pass them out right now if we would all indulge me. Here we go. Andy, please.
Oh, okay. Who are we?
I'll read stage direction. Andy, Red Ranger. Okay. Nick, Pink.
Yes.
Joe, Robot Scientist.
Okay.
All right. This is in the middle. This is the climax of the movie. No pun intended. Mechagodzilla hits the Megazord with its metal tail. The Megazord looks like it's on its last legs.
The Megazord is on its last legs!
Pink Ranger, Nick.
Wait, I'm getting a transmission from a scientist that created Mechagodzilla.
Hello, Rangers. The key to beating Mechagodzilla is not fists, it's love.
Cue the song Let's Get It On, the most cliched lovemaking song in all of cinema.
Oh, I get it, Rangers. Follow my lead!
The Megazord wearily stands up. It blows a sexy kiss to Mechagodzilla. Mechagodzilla is flattered. The Megazord struts its stuff sexily in front of Mechagodzilla. Wow, Mechagodzilla is really into this. Mechagodzilla swings his tiny robot arms at the Megazord's hard metal abs.
It's working.
The robots start going at it. Hardcore, bleeping and S-ing. Like crazy stuff that you can't even imagine, like crazy robot stuff.
Let's get the Dragonzord involved.
Red Ranger summons the Dragonzord. It's a giant robot orgy. Also, Titanicus, I think that's his name, is in the corner watching. The city is saved. And also, they get to see a cool show.
Ha ha! Well, I always knew making a horny robot would be good.
He puts on a nightshirt and cap and settles down for a long winter's nap.
Scene.
The greatest sex scene of all time, Mechagodzilla versus the Megazord.
Good luck, Nick.
Yes. Well, can I both say both are beautiful? Both are beautiful choices, and I respect you two more than I've ever respected two
people.
I would
also like to say that Mike's not the only one who wrote a page of his.
Oh. All right. Well, let me go first. When I think of sexiness and I think of masculinity and power and romance and passion and a poet's heart, but also a warrior's heart. And that's why I want to take two sides of the one coin and do the most erotic, tantric, longest lovemaking scene in the history of film with the two sexiest people who have ever been in cinema. Dalton from Roadhouse, played by Patrick Swayze, and Johnny Castle from Dancing, Dirty Dancing, played by Patrick Swayze. These two men are warriors and heroes all, and they would perform the greatest Cinema 69 in history. These two are lithe. They're strong. They're built. They have endurance. They have power, but they also have compassion. Think about Dalton, the warrior. He will rip someone's throat out, but he wants to just help a town of people. And then you have Johnny Castle, who wants to help a town of people, but through dance. And the two of them will do a romantic dance with each other that will delight our hearts and minds and also make us think. Because you know what? No one puts Dalton in a castle. No one puts Dalton in a corner besides Johnny Castle. And that's why these two are would be the sexiest lovemaking scene of all time.
Mike, may I?
Sure.
Interior, Yareth Bespin Casino Penthouse. Catherine Tramell enters to find Lando already waiting for her. She knows he's been searching for proof that she's behind the recent string of killings in Cloud City, but she also knows that he knows that she's got no underwear on. She lights a space cigarette. There's no smoking in Cloud City, Miss Tramell. What are you going to do, Mr. Calrissian? Arrest me for smoking? Lando laughs. The smile makes his mustache flex like an oily bodybuilder's arm. They slowly move towards each other. Both know where this is headed. You look absolutely beautiful, Catherine. You truly belong with us. You truly belong here with us among the clouds. It's the perfect place to write my new book. What's your new book about? A swindler. He falls for the wrong woman. What happens to him? She kills him. And then they F for ages, both knowing that one of them is going to stab the other one with an ice pick. That's tension. That's build. That's subtext. America wants to see these two bang. Sharon Stone meets the face of Colt 45 in a cape. Are you kidding me? That is a videotape marked Tiny Toons that is in the room of every 90s 14-year-old boy and girl across the world.
Carlson, may?
Yeah.
You sure? Yes, yeah. Everyone may.
Yeah.
Do you page two?
Yes. Dalton walks from the roadhouse into a barn. He's like the wind through his dreams. Johnny Castle walks from the dance hall to the barn shirtless. He rides the night next to me. They lead through the moonlight only to burn with the sun. He's taken my heart, but he doesn't know what he's done. They make love, and then guess what happens? This union is blessed by Patrick Swayze from Ghost. And they all dance and sing. And think about, and then
wait,
also.
While they're having sex?
And then, yeah, because he feels his
wait,
breath.
Wait, is it Patrick Swayze Ghost as one of them?
No. He's just watching.
Oh, okay.
And then anointing this holy trinity.
Is he doing anything while he's watching?
He's jerking off. He's jerking off. His body close to me. He can't look in his eyes. He's out of his leagues. They're just fool to believe I have anything they need. This is the greatest thing in the world. And also, it doesn't have Lando Calrissian possibly dying. It doesn't have that. You want to kill a hero. And then also,
I don't want to kill a hero.
Megazord was never
tension.
In a movie. I thought about it.
Of course the Megazord was in a movie.
He was Power in Power Rangers the movie.
No, yes. That wasn't Megazord.
Yes, it was Megazord.
No, that was the ninja one. That was Ninja Megazord.
Uh-oh, Mike.
Uh-oh. Dan is going to have to check that one.
Here's
okay. Check it, Dan.
Megazord in a movie. Here's my issue with multiple Patrick Swayzes.
What?
Patrick Swayze,
too sexy for you?
God bless his soul, was a chain smoker. And that is three very smelly chains. That is enough cigarette smoke that
we
I will smell it through the screen.
Sharon Stone smoke.
No, I'm watching it. I'm watching it. I'm going to smell that through the screen.
It's not that
like
smell-o-vision movie they have down at LA Live.
And besides, Sharon Stone smoke. And you know, Lando was doing Cloud City cigarettes.
The important thing is that Nick is into like twin porn or triplet porn. What
yeah,
are you talking
see, I don't
about?
Like that.
I don't want the same guy like kissing.
I
the only
person
like
that
a
can,
brother.
The
it's
only
like
one
brothers.
That can match up to Patrick Swayze's sexuality is Patrick Swayze.
I want to see
you want two robots.
The same guy.
But Carlson, way to pick the obvious like Carlson robot. I'm lazy. I don't want to do this. Robots.
I want to see the sexiest man in sci-fi. Bang, the sexiest woman in erotic thrillers. Megazord and Mechagodzilla, for one thing, it just seems a little robotic. But two, Megazord is created by a bunch of teenagers. That is multiple people trying to control the sexual moves of one robot. And they're dorky teenagers. Most of them have never effed. This is going to be an awkward, uncomfortable, bad sex scene.
And it wasn't the Ninja Megazord.
Zordon may have created the... I don't think the teenagers didn't actually build it. That's a side
they
note.
They run it.
They run it, certainly.
Hey, you but know who created Patrick Swayze? God.
That's right.
And then he made him act in movies, and then we get to imagine them in erotic situations.
We've seen... Joe had a very nice... a romantic novel that everyone's grandmother would get a little bit moist when they read, all right? It was fine, but it's nothing we haven't seen before. I want giant lumbering sex happening above a city, folks.
Controlled by a team of five virgins that don't know what they're doing.
A couple of them have gotten laid.
I'm sorry, I've seen robots fuck.
Robot check.
It's not that cool.
Fact check. Have you seen skyscraper-sized robots have sex before?
Yes.
In person?
Yes!
I don't want to see.
Yes.
Really?
I don't want to see novice skyscraper-sized robots have sex.
Novice?
And then,
Mecha says, in this movie, Mechagodzilla was built to have sex.
And you're literally putting Lando on a pedestal of death. He has a 50% shot of him dying.
This isn't about killing, this is about banging.
No, you said they both have ice picks.
Yeah,
I want a celebration of love and life. That's why I want Dalton banging Johnny Castle.
Nothing elevates this bit. Like, they're not even like doing it while Lobot is in the background DJing or something. They're not even doing it on a speeder.
It's
that was the most boring setup to just like a murder. We want something at least fun. Make something fun. Maybe do that in the carbonite chamber. I'm helping you out, bro.
I'm sorry. I don't want two robots 9-11-ing a city while they bang the shit out of each other. I want...
Badly.
We're going to explain it away and say, oh, the city has been mostly evacuated like they did at the end
Superman. By the way, it wasn't Ninja Megazord. That was the movie. I saw the movie. That was a movie I saw, you dicks.
I don't think you get to win this on a technicality, though.
No, I don't want to. I'm winning it on the sweet abs and lithe skin of one Patrick Swayze.
Look, Patrick Swayze over and over again can win a lot of arguments in life, but not this one. Lando and Catherine Tremell are proven sexy, sexy beasts. They are in their respective films purely for sex appeal. This robot is driven by virgin teenagers. I don't know the sexual history of Mechagodzilla. I've got to assume that he's new to this, too.
There's nothing wrong with being a virgin.
Final thoughts, Mike?
There is if I'm going to jerk off to it.
That's true.
I'm creepy, boring.
I'm sorry. It's two robots.
Boring.
Like, which I've seen before. And I'm sorry,
You're not going to distract me with Flash and blah, blah, blah.
I don't want the threat.
It's a distraction, Mike.
I don't want the
threat of Lando.
Hold on, let Nick have his final thought.
I don't want Lando to possibly die. Like, that's the position you put him in. Instead, I just want... We said best sex scene. And I'm sorry, who would have the best sex scene... With Patrick Swayze besides Patrick Swayze. It would be two Patrick Swayzes.
I think Lando
can have sex. He was into tantric sex. No, Lando's a wham bam thank you ma'am. He is a rough trick, but Swayze would be smooth and enjoyable for men and women alike.
All right, Dan, how are we doing over there?
Great.
Anything to add to do we know
are you crying?
Is Megazord on TV or movies? Do
we know? Megazord is in the Power Rangers TV show, and there's does it matter?
No,
really?
No.
I'm just giving you some screen
Megazord
time. I like enjoy hearing you talk.
This is their show. I don't know.
So polite.
Sure.
I'm pretty fine.
I think it appeared in the movie. I'm trying to find
Ninja
out.
Megazord.
It was a Megazord. I don't know if it was technically the Ninja Megazord.
There was a Ninja Megazord in the movie.
Okay, well, you count it. It counts.
Yeah.
All right. It's tough for me, but.
Was that our first It's Tough of the show?
Yeah. This was tough. Because I'd watch all three of those, to be honest.
Cheers,
I think we all would.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he started with the greatest 69 and then ended with the fact that yours could die and, you know, the robot's interesting. I got to strangely give this one to Nick. I think he went outside the box and picked something I think we'd all enjoy watching.
That's
going to be very handsome. So what that does, though, is it puts us at a three-way tie.
Can I suggest something?
I'm already... Like, I already have a plan, because as you were going, I thought this might happen, and then it didn't change. So do we have a cup? Thank you. All right, guys, can you please pick your numbers here?
Here are two revolvers. You have to duel from one end of the stage.
We have three in there. Great. Pick one.
You guys, this is the best day of my life.
Because we're going to do a bonus round. Because it's not fair. One of you is going to lose, is how this one works. Pass it down. Just hand him one, you take one. All right, guys, what's your numbers?
Two.
Three.
One.
Three, one, and two for Nick. Okay. Guys, I'm going to add a bonus round. I hope you guys are prepared for this.
No.
What movie would have been better had it added a scene where a guy plays a saxophone in the rain? We're adding this round. This was one that was talked about, so you guys did have a little bit of thought on this one. It was rejected from the show, and now it gets to make a huge debut. What film would improve if you added a scene of a saxophone guy playing in the rain? Now, Joe, you were pulled number one. You get to go first.
Okay. The point of a saxophone solo in the rain scene in a film is to break tension. It's to to give some emotional release to a character. It's to give the audience a chance to breathe along with the protagonist. A small break, if you will, before all hell breaks loose in a third act. That is a good saxophone solo in the rain to me. And the film that would most benefit from said scene is The Revenant. The Revenant is
Where do you put this break?
I'm glad you asked, Andy. The sax solo would happen after Leonardo DiCaprio has been rescued by that random Native American who builds the little mud cabin around him. Leo wakes up in his hallucination, and that Native American is playing Baker Street on the saxophone. Is it a hallucination given to him to empower him by his dead wife? Is it real? I don't know. The Revenant.
Cut to Dan. Look at that. Come on, JT.
Couldn't have made that movie any worse.
Thank you, Dan. I couldn't have said that better myself.
When you hear him snorting, you got to cut to him, okay? So, Nick, you're up next. Good luck.
Yeah, okay. Saxophone solo is a celebration. It's a mighty cheer from the heavens.
Absolutely.
It's when, but I look at it as a third act, when evil's been vanquished and a hot black dude with no shirt pops into a courthouse after Tom Hanks and Denzel Washington their case in Philadelphia. That's right. When they stop the corporation who fired Tom Hanks because he had AIDS, that's when a hot black dude kicks open the doors and sings a sweet saxophone solo with his sax. And then everyone's celebrating, enjoying, and it cures him. It cures Tom Hanks. That's right. It cures Tom Hanks from his disease, and everyone wins. And then Denzel Washington and Tom Hanks start a private detective
agency. Is there a song on the sax they're playing?
It's Baker Street.
It is Baker Street.
It's also Baker Street. I'm doing a jazz arrangement of Baker Street. I want to make
Very clear. I'm doing more of like a Latin fusion because it's Philadelphia, and it's like they have a powerful Latin community.
Okay, Mike?
It's important.
All right, mine is, again, pretty obvious, but I'm going to choose the Michael Moore documentary, Roger and Me. Michael Moore is trying to expose, you know, the corruption of business, and he's trying to unearth a lot of things. And I just don't feel that in the movie we got his frustration enough. All right, he was frustrated because Roger wouldn't meet with him. All right, that's why he had no choice but to take to the streets of Detroit in the middle of the rain, strip him down to nothing but underwear, close his eyes, and soulfully play the song Baker Street. To really let people know what's going on in this country. It's the scene that I always thought when I watched the movie was clearly omitted. It must be on the cutting room floor somewhere. Roger and me.
I too thought all these scenes were deleted. And then I checked.
I mean, this is tough, guys. But
the question
do?
Is, what movie is made better and needs it the most? And The Revenant is one long, unfun slog of a man suffering and suffering and suffering on one single note. Beautifully shot, but God damn if it doesn't
Here's
need
what I'm
a sax
do, guys.
In the
pick,
rain.
Pick the worst one. And right here. Mike, go ahead.
The Revenant, because where did he get the sax?
Nick.
The Revenant, because he didn't cure AIDS.
Philadelphia, because it's in the third act and doesn't need it. That's not what saxophone solos in the rain are about.
That is what saxophone solos are about.
What's the best one, aside from yours? So that means you're picking...
Philadelphia.
Roger and me. Roger and me.
Revenant.
Okay, that didn't help me at all. Sorry, no, keep fighting.
Useless time.
What? Which guy of all three of these guys do you want to see?
He doesn't have AIDS.
Nick is just yelling AIDS.
You can't yell Patrick Swayze over and over again to win a fight and then just yell AIDS and expect to win another fight.
I did, but it happens. And then here's the thing.
Guys, you have both said that saxophone solos in the rain are about frustration. What is more frustrating than surviving a bear attack and slowly crawling to the man that left you for dead? He needs that saxophone solo to keep going. Where did the saxophone come from?
That's a good question.
From the ghost, from his wife
Who's
and his son that he keeps saying.
Wait a minute.
No, there are not holes in this because I left it up to debate if it was a hallucination or if it was real. He's hallucinating that night. He's going crazy.
Andy, I described my saxophone player a hot, shirtless black dude. Who is your saxophone player?
A helpful Native American man. We both said it.
Michael Moore in his underwear. There's a scene where he goes to a Detroit music store and purchases it. It's a whole thing. It's 5 minutes, and he's negotiating the price, and he's telling him about Roger, who won't meet with him.
I want
Roger to meet with me. He starts wailing.
I want to know that when Leonardo DiCaprio pushes Tom Hardy down that stream to be killed by those Native Americans and then looks at the camera for no reason, the thing that got him there was a saxophone solo played in the rain by a helpful Native American man who built a mud hut for him.
I don't think saxophone solos need to be about despair. I think it can be a celebration. It is a celebration.
But it's a surge of positivity in a completely self-serious movie. Enter E2 needs a sax solo.
And that's why it like scores the moment where that corporation was vanquished by Denzel Washington, put aside his homophobia.
That's the end, though. There's nothing special about
it's
that.
It's very special. It's even specialer.
If Michael Moore had played sax right outside of his office with no clothes on, I think he would have gone to the Roger would have gone to the window and say, "What's that? What it?" And then he would hear it in his heart.
Here's the problem with Roger and me. This country still sucks.
He would feel like he could survive a bear attack.
The country might be in a better shape if that sax solo had happened in that movie.
All right, final thought. Go ahead, Mike. Finish it out. Is that it?
That was it.
Do we have this poll up?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
I think a great movie could have been even greater where you took a shitty movie and made it okay.
I think in terms of movies that desperately would be most improved by a sax solo, Revenant is not fun. It's kind of monotonous. It needs that sax solo to break things up.
All right, guys on the couch, anything to add? We do have a poll?
There is a poll.
Is there a clear winner?
There's a clear winner, yes.
Is there a clear loser?
It's early. It's early in the poll. And I will say, these polls are biased by older films. So that could help and hurt or hurt some people in this competition.
I'm going to go with my gut on this one, okay, guys?
Okay.
It's a tough choice, and Andy, I respect any decision you make.
I mean, I gotta eliminate the worst one in my mind, and because I'm going to take the other two to the finals, is how this is going to work. And I don't want to say worse. That's mean. Not the strongest argument, is what I heard. And I did just hear you yelling AIDS, and he's a black guy, and I just don't think there was much else of an argument there. Also, very odd. I think as odd as The Revenant and Why Dreamy were, they sold me a little harder. So I'm going to use my logical brain, Nick. Sadly, I'm going to have to eliminate you from this weird fight. You're out.
I got to scream AIDS a lot, and I think
congratulations. Mike and Joe both get the point. That puts them at 3 points each. They move into the final weird speed round. And Nick, I hope you will stay and help me determine a winner.
Sure.
Very fantastic job, though, from Nick Mundy. Can we give him a round of applause?
Look, Nick Mundy's a good guy, a good friend.
Hey, man.
Happy to be shouted.
Hey,
what did the poll? How did the poll?
Hey, like it always happens, the new guy always goes up.
The poll was 56% Revenant, 29% Philadelphia, 15% Roger.
Yeah, everyone should see Roger. It's a great documentary.
It is a great documentary.
Like Ric Flair, he made us look good.
Yeah,
he did. All right, guys, before we get to this weird speed round, which is, trust me, it's going to be epic.
I'm sorry, and I love you.
I have to thank our sponsors once again at Loot Crate. Dan has some of the items over there that I'm sure he'll be holding up again, and so does Pete. But I got to thank him because they're supporting this show and the process, and we love them for it. So please go click the annotation or visit lootcrate.com/moviefights if you're listening on iTunes or anywhere else. Sign up, and we'll help you save 10% off a new subscription using code MOVIEFIGHTS. You have until 6:19 at 9 p.m. Pacific Standard Time to subscribe and receive the Dystopia Crate, which includes amazing items from RoboCop. I'd buy that for $1. Terminator 2, Judgment Day, I'll be back. And Matrix, whoa. Is that
that was solid.
It's good. So much more. So tune in. I love that oven mitt.
It's a nice oven mitt.
That's a cool oven mitt.
It is.
You get cool stuff like that if you just subscribe and sign up for Loot Crate. So go do it. Save 10% and support this show in the process. Lootcrate.com/moviefights. Code MOVIEFIGHTS. Thank you, Loot Crate. All right. Let's keep this weird. Pete, Dan, and Nick, you guys will be helping me.
I'm still playing, right?
No, you're out.
Okay, I'll keep playing.
No.
Still it's out. Weird.
The rules are weird.
All right, guys, the speed round. We've picked 5 weird questions. You guys will have to answer these quickly. And again, the scores are 3-3. Any questions? You both have seen the show. You know how this works. You'll have 20 seconds and then 10-second rebuttals. If you say the same name first, we'll get that choice. The other person will have to select another option. Mm-hmm. Any questions before we begin the speed round?
Honored to be in this with Mr. Carlson.
All right. Now, remember, the time starts when you start speaking. I'm going to ask the first question right now, and go ahead and give us your answers. What director should make the Chewbacca Mom movie?
Like a shitty director.
Shh. Chris Columbus.
Edgar Wright.
Okay. Edgar Wright and Chris Columbus. Joe, you were up first. Chris Columbus, time starts when you start talking. Chewbacca Mom, the movie, directed by Chris Columbus.
Chewbacca Mom is all about family, and there is no stronger family director in this fight than Chris Columbus. The Harry Potter films, Home Alone, I think. Many other family movies. I think he'll get the tone to really make this a widely appealing box office hit. He's done enough fantasy that I think he can do a...
Mike.
Chewbacca Mom movie doesn't take itself so seriously. Edgar Wright's movies are all very fun, self-referential. They point out the things. They make kind of winks towards the camera. They're great. Edgar Wright has never made a bad movie. Also, I always pick Edgar Wright when we're in the speed round. People have pointed that out because he's never made a bad movie. He's going to beat Chris Columbus because Chris Columbus hasn't been doing well lately as far as his quality of his films.
10 seconds, Joe.
Chris Columbus is going to make a film that all of our kids are going to like, and that's going to be Chewbacca Mom. That's the Chewbacca Mom movie I like. It's for the kids, like Ewoks was.
Mike.
Chewbacca Mom is the ultimate underdog. That is what Edgar Wright does well. She is somebody who we don't think of as a hero, as not a conventional hero, and he's perfect at that. He takes somebody who you don't think is going to rise up, and she is going to...
Ooh. Pete and Dan the couch, any thoughts?
It was close, but I gotta give the edge to Joe on that. I would actually go the other way. They were both good arguments, but I didn't think Joe really knocked down Mike's choice, so I would actually go with Mike on that one.
Nick.
Carlson.
I think I was really close with Columbus because I liked your family start, but then you didn't give me a little bit
I didn't punch
wide
back.
Enough to punch it, so first point to Mike.
How many do we have to win?
Three.
Got so many, I think.
Yeah.
Number two. If you had to eat any actor, who would it be?
Finally, we're getting to the questions that...
If you had to eat any actor, who would it be? All right, time's running out. Brad Pitt.
Michael B. Jordan.
Whoa. Okay, we got Michael B. Jordan from Joe, but first up, Brad Pitt from Mike. Go ahead, time starts when you talk.
When you're eating barbecue, you want something that has been slow cooked over a long time, something that's been taken care of. Okay? Brad Pitt has taken incredible care of himself for so many years. He has aged a little bit more. There is more flavor in that meat. That is something that is going to hit all of your taste buds and explode. Michael B. Jordan, he's going to be delicious, but he's not going to have that extra bit of seasoning and flavor.
I think Brad Pitt is going to be kind of rugged. He's going to taste a little too aged, like he's been left out a day or two. He's just older. Michael, when I'm going to eat a person, I want something fancy. I want a treat. Did you see Michael B. Jordan in Creed? He's sweating. He's glistening. He's beautiful. I want to lick that man. He looks amazing. He looks delicious.
Okay, 10-second rebuttal, Mike.
Brad Pitt has been doing crunches for 50 years. All right, can you imagine what that ab meat tastes like? This would be a delicacy. This is something they would pay big money. He's a bigger star.
Okay, last punch. Here's go ahead, Joe.
Look, the younger meat is just going to taste better. Michael B. Jordan is veal. Brad Pitt is just an older steak. It depends on your taste, but I'm going to go with Michael B. Jordan. The man's delicious. He is one big ab.
Can I ask one question?
Sure, Nick.
Which wine would you pair them with?
Sir? I'll allow 10 more seconds to talk about the wine, yeah, right?
Okay. 10 more seconds.
Just think about it. Just give it a second.
A dry Chardonnay would pair very well with Brad Pitt, especially the ab meat, because the ab meat is going to be something that's going to be a little bit juicier, and you want something that actually that'll kind of cleanse your palate once you have the wine.
I'm going to go with the Diablo Red served on Gordon Ramsay's Hell's Kitchen because it is already served with his beef Wellington. It's proved to pair well with meats chosen by Gordon Ramsay himself.
Whew. Did I help you, Nick, make a decision? Who are you picking?
Yes.
Based on the arguments.
You had me until the Chardonnay, friend. I'm gonna go with Joe. Joe gets the point.
Nick's not allowed to call the point, by the way.
I like Joe's argument for freshness, I think.
Joe's freshness argument.
Voted for me in the whole show.
Dan, any thoughts before I make the ruling?
I'd probably go with Mike, but they both made good arguments. Good arguments.
Yeah, I mean, I did like the veal argument. That was strong at the end. You did pull it. Thank you. I gotta go with Joe.
Thank you.
You had to tell the Chardonnay.
Yeah, and that didn't help.
Yeah, does everyone not like Chardonnay?
No, it's a Chardonnay. Chardonnay's a trash wine.
Look, I know two things. It's which young actors I want to eat and wines.
Okay, here we go, guys. Here we go. Next up.
Can we please do wine?
All right, next up. Guys, please pitch a new Look Who's Talking franchise.
This was my question.
All right. Kevin James is a single dad, and he's got six kids, all right? And these kids all talk to each other, and he is in over his head. Also, he's a zookeeper in this and a mall cop at night. Okay, so the kids talk to him. They're having fun adventures, and they like kind of go off, and they do their own thing, and he's not quite aware of the kids talking because he's busy being a zookeeper.
Okay, so just to verify, I heard kids and animals, zoo cop, zookeeper slash mall cop. Look Who's Talking.
Kevin James.
Kevin James. Okay, Joe. Time starts when you talk.
Will Ferrell is a hardworking dad, taking care of two kids who he's adopted, voiced by The Rock and Brie Larson, two of the hottest Hollywood actors working right now. Comedic chops, all three of them. Will Ferrell's proved that he has the heart with that last scene in the Lego movie. He can do a fantastic family film. The Rock's is box office gold. Brie.
This is Kevin James's type of movie, and my kids are voiced by Aziz Ansari, Dick Van Dyke, Ed Asner, Mary Tyler Moore, Gavin McLeod, the rest of the Mary Tyler Moore show cast.
I just need to understand, who's talking in yours? Just kids? Go ahead, Joe, last time, 10 seconds.
The kids are talking, Rock and Brie Larson. Kevin James has no type of movie, Mike Carlson. How dare you, sir? Will Ferrell can be a tender dad with these kids that get into all kinds of shenanigans in the city of Chicago.
But what's his job, though?
Yeah, so here's where
I'm... Is he a zookeeper?
I gotta give Joe... I'll go first. I like Joe's casting, but I liked Mike's movie better based on the argument. Where do you stand, Nick?
He had two jobs. Will Ferrell didn't have any, like a deadbeat.
So you're going with Mike?
Yeah.
Dan and Pete?
I would side with Mike as well.
Yeah, so...
Me too. I gotta give him my credit.
I don't need your pity. You keep it.
Okay, Mike got the point on that one, so that puts us at...
So Joe needs to win this one to tie it to stay in the game, basically. If Mike wins this point, he wins the game.
Got it.
Ooh, if Joe wins this point, we go to the final question.
Okay.
Probably going.
Ready, guys? Make a movie better by casting Larry the Cable Guy in the title role.
Showgirls.
Go ahead, Joe, when you're ready.
The Golden Child.
Okay, Eddie Murphy vehicle, yep.
Wait, who's he playing?
Eddie Murphy, the
Golden
title.
Child.
Okay. No.
The title character.
No, it said the title character in the question.
Title character, the Golden Child, and he's playing the showgirl. Okay.
Okay, that's fine.
Go ahead, Mike.
All right, this is exactly the same movie, not even changing it to Thunder from 900. He is going into Cheetahs, or whatever they call that ladies' club. He is trying to become part of this ladies' club. He is trying to break down a barrier by being the first hillbilly to be in an all-female review. This is an incredible movie, folks. They'll say, get her done. He's also going to have his nipples. He gets humiliated by the guy.
Guys, this is an 80s classic where Eddie Murphy has to rescue a Mongolian wizard boy played by Larry the Cable Guy. It is like nothing you have ever seen. Larry the Cable Guy dressed like a little Mongolian wizard boy with his little Mongolian wizard boy underwear being saved by Eddie Murphy. He has the brain of an adult Larry the Cable Guy say, oh, get her done. Hey, Eddie, where are we going? I'm a golden child.
In my movie, Larry the Cable Guy gets his period and then says, that ain't right. Okay, that's the famous moment from my movie. That's a better movie, folks.
In my movie, Eddie Murphy and Larry the Cable Guy are on the run from Saddam Numsi in demon form, and Larry the Cable Guy says, woo, keep on trucking, Eddie! Because he keeps calling him Eddie the whole movie and not by his character name.
Ooh, Dan over there, Pete, thoughts?
Oh, damn.
I have no idea.
You know, Joe did it for me when Larry the Cable Guy called him Eddie. and not the character name. That really got me.
Okay, so you got a vote to Joe. Anyone on the couch want to give a vote?
I'll throw it back into your court and say Mike, I guess.
Oh, you like Mike, okay.
Well, I think that his iconic scene was a little more memorable.
It's very iconic. That ain't right.
This is the best movie fights.
Sorry, Mike.
It's not like you.
But, gee whiz.
But how do you judge these rounds? I don't know.
Exactly. through integrity?
No personal offense.
So it comes back to me. I think it was very close for me, but I do think Get Her Done. What was the line? I can't remember it, so it must have been memorable.
That ain't right.
That Ain't Right was too memorable for me to ignore. I got to give it to Mike. That means Mike gets the point. That means you win. Weird movie fight, but very cool. How about a round of applause for Joe Starr as well? And Nick Mundy. Wow. That was weird. That was insanely weird.
We did it.
We did it. We did the best thing ever.
We sure did it. Guys, what a fun show. I'm about to tease Drunk Movie Fights, but before I do, I want to thank our fans here. Pete on the fan cam. Pete, Silent 10 Warrior on Twitter?
Yes, that's correct.
I hope you had fun.
Yes, it was crazy. Sorry, Mike. You're actually one of my favorite fighters.
There's no need to apologize.
Dan Murrell.
And I just want to talk to a guy. He quote tweeted the "If you had any eat in the actor, who would it be?" question. Chris West said, "I think Movie Fights Live is losing steam." Who wrote these questions? Chris, I hope you're just not watching this episode. Go back and watch, because
he's
like, time to hire some new writers. Yeah, Chris, watch the episode.
Chris, hopefully you'll watch it later and stop judging, because you're
the episode.
Clearly not watching it. Plus,
yes. In a cockroach costume.
He has no idea what he's missing.
He has no clue.
That's
what
YouTube
missing.
In general, though, is
Chris,
reacting before you really
Chris
know
West.
What's happening.
Chris
pull
West
the stick
Twitter.
Out, buddy.
Go,
pull the stick out.
Go
let's not
watch
give his name out.
Live. No, he tweeted it. He made it public.
Dan wants you to attack him. Get him.
All right, guys, next week, before I give you plugs, next week we're back with Drunk Movie Fights. And in order to do this properly, I had a plan. We had, I think someone actually tweeted this, and then you know what, this makes sense. So we're going to do, we had round one, Ken Knapsack. If you haven't watched Drunk Movie Fights number one, go watch it, it's amazing. But Ken won that round, spoiler alert. So he moves on to the next round, and we are going to have two more episodes over the course of the next, I think every couple months or so, we'll do it. Probably another one. We'll have one on next week, probably another one in August, something, and probably then Oktoberfest. We're going to do a championship Drunk Movie Fights belt.
Ooh.
So
yeah. It's going
to
be a belt.
I'm excited to introduce. Do we have the graphic ready? Next week, you will be able to see these three people get drunk with us. Alicia Malone, Scott Mance, and Hal Rudnick.
Jesus. That's going to be great.
This is going to be very intense. These three are very ready to get drunk with us and see what happens. Let's see who's the best drunk. I want you to tell us who you think is going to win, who you're rooting for. And I'd like you to submit your topics, which you can go over to my Facebook. We did that for this round. It's a good way to police them, thumb up them, thumb down. Facebook.com/AndySignore. Start submitting your questions over for movie fights, drunk movie fights for next week with those three players. I'm very excited. Guys. Now that we got all those plugs away, I got to plug you hard. Mike Carlson of Fat Carlson, you did great today.
Thank you.
Congrats.
Thank you.
Where can people find you?
Fat Carlson on Twitter and whatever else you like. Snapchat too, I think. Instagram, all that stuff. Star Wars Card Trader. If you're watching this on Saturday, you can go to the Upright Citizen Brigade Theater and see the very funny Joe Starr defend his belt and me. In the Tournament of Nerds.
It's the best show in town.
Dolph Ziggler is the judge from WWE.
It is the best show in town.
So all of that. And thanks to Mohawk Jimmy for harassing us to get this fight. Yeah. He did it like every day for like...
harass your heroes.
It happens.
Yep.
Nick Mundy at Dick Fundy.
Yeah, guys.
Mundy Night Raw every Monday at 4 p.m. ScreenJunkies Plus.
Well, since you're plugging that, I just got to plug my Thunderbird. I'm going to be showing it at the Bob's Big Boy Saturday in Burbank.
Is Leno going to be there?
Yeah, it's going to look pretty smooth.
Inside talk.
I worked on my tires, and I got some nude leather sheen. I think it's going to look pretty good.
Fantastic. Hopefully Joe Starr, what an amazing debut. Joe Starr.
Thank you, sir. Thank you guys
Joe
for Starr, having me.
Joe Starr, 187 on Twitter. Anything you'd like to plug?
Guys, you can get my stand-up album, Heroic Effort, on iTunes. And if you're in Southern California, go to UCB,
Saturday, midnight, me and Mike Carlson, hopefully rematching for this. Dolph Ziggler's judging, Hal Rudnick hosting. It's a show that you should
Mark
not miss.
Mark and Draco, right?
Mark and Draco.
We're going to do a Screen Junkies edition someday.
That would be fantastic.
You got to fly out to L.A. just to see the show.
Yeah, and if not, it's a lot, and it's monthly, so you can always catch it up. Follow Hal and Joe and all these people. They'll tell you where to go. Guys, thank you so much for watching. What a fun, weird episode. Tell us if you want to see it again, or just judge it before you watch it, because that's apparently a thing, too.
You dick.
But no, we love you all. Thank you for watching. We do this to have fun. Say whatever you like, because you're allowed. Yep. And we'll just...
Thank you, Andy! Hey, Andy! Hey, thanks for letting us do this weird crap!
Yeah! Thanks for coming, everybody! And thanks for having fun with us. We'll see you next week on Drunk Movie Fights. Have a great one. Bye-bye!
Every podcast we put on YouTube comes with this kick-ass graphic listing all the topics your favorite Screen Junkies podcasters are talking about. If you click the topics, you can skip around and choose your own podcast battle royale. Go ahead, try them all. If you haven't already, subscribe to Screen Junkies on YouTube to join us for future fights. Or if you prefer to listen on iTunes, click the logo to download an audio version.